Welcome to the VoiceOver Sermon with Terry Daniel, the podcast for voiceover artists with tons of handy tips, tricks, and useful information to help you run your voiceover business better. And now, here's your host, Terry Daniel.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to another episode of VoiceOver Sermons. And we're going back 15 years, Trish, because it's just you and I on this episode.
Oh, wow. It's been quite some time.
Oh, yeah. We did, for those of you not familiar with our old podcast, we did, here's how old it was. I titled all of our episodes in caps.
Is that a thing or not a thing? Yeah, I don't even know.
Because I was terrible online. You should see some of my old blogs. It's just poor grammar. They're not, I mean, there's good tips, but they weren't written very well. And then every episode of VoiceOvers on Demand was in these big, bold caps.
If you still want to listen to those old episodes, by the way, they're at voiceovercafe.org.
No, please don't promote them.
Go to the website and scroll all the way down.
You'll hear that kind of aggravation.
Our voices have even changed, but you know, since then. It's so weird. That's how long ago it was. I didn't even know what a podcast was when you presented the idea to me.
What was that,
2006?
Oh, yeah, like 2006. I had no idea what we were even recording on. I think it was like Stick'em or Stick AM.
Stick Cam.
I think that's what we recorded on, wasn't it? Some of the old apps before.
I thought it was Skype, actually.
Oh, it could have been Skype.
Stick Cam was a video program.
Oh, okay. Well, there wasn't like Spreaker or some of these other wonderful platforms. And what's nice about VoiceOvers on Demand is half of our guests that we had on there have now banned us. So from seeing their stuff, because we've taken a couple shots at a few.
We're still friends with a few of them,
though. Snake oil artists out there, and they didn't really like what we had to say, and the next thing I know, we're blocked.
I know. Such is politics.
Sometimes you pay the price for telling the truth.
Yeah, industry politics have definitely gotten in the way of a few things. But we're still friends with a few people.
We have
Eric Shepard.
Yeah, most people are great. I'm just, of course, I'm exaggerating like crazy. And to be quite honest with you, business politics can be just as aggravating as regular politics.
I agree.
But
definitely.
So Trish and I obviously coach together. And before we talk about anything else, you know, usually every quarter, usually, at least I try to, we've got so much to do, but I will send an email out asking for feedback on our coaching sessions. Is there anything that we're leaving out? You know, what do you like about our program? What can we improve upon? And based on the positive feedback that we always get back, I'm not boasting about it, but it's always very positive. Tell me a little bit. You already do a marketing session with our students, and maybe we can touch on that. What do you cover in a marketing session? And then tell us a little bit about what you are going to cover in a more integrated voiceover business session.
Sure. So the marketing session, I really, you know, I've always been a huge fan of direct marketing. Yes, I was on the pay-to-plays many, many years ago, but I have been able to build my business and get to the point where I don't make a living from pay-to-plays. In fact, I don't get any of my income from pay-to-plays. And less than about 20% of my income comes from my agents, which I have 7 of them. So it definitely is something that I've done really well with just marketing directly to clients. And I've always said this, but, you know, look for clients. Don't look for jobs. You know, look for people that are going to hire you over and over and over again and develop relationships with those people.
Getting into
like creative directors at ad agencies. You know, if you've ever watched Mad Men, you're looking for the Don Draper of the ad agency. He's the guy that hires the talent. Some of them use the pay-to-plays and some of them use talent agencies. But generally, sometimes, you know, they have like a folder on their computer with just a bunch of talent demos in it. And they, recommend talent to clients as they come in and want campaigns. You know, I use this example all the time. If any of our students are listening, Tony's Pizza Yep. You know, comes to the ad agency and comes to Don Draper and says, hey, you know, we want to do, we have three locations in our area and we want to do a radio campaign. What can you do for us? And so Don Draper basically says, okay, great. Well, we can recommend this type of voice for a pizza parlor. So here are, and presents the voices that he recommends to Tony's Pizza. So then Tony's Pizza then either chooses one voice that they really like, or they narrow it down to a handful. And then those talent get an email. So basically, I teach people how to do that and the details that are, you know, involved in actually looking for work and finding the right people.
Right. So I don't mean to interrupt, if I could just interject for a second, because I always storm the forums on a daily or weekly basis just to kind of hear what people are talking about. And it just feels like, you know, a lot of newer talents are so focused on the pay-to-play stuff. You know, they're talking about, oh, I sent 100 auditions in yesterday, or, oh, I sent 200 in today, when, you know, it's so important, especially these days, to market to the potential voiceover buyer. And you already know this about me. I mean, I get a lot of jobs, you know, in these big corporations that have in-house video production studios, you know, mm-hmm. that do a lot of the e-learning and explainer video. Mm-hmm. These are the clients that people need to spend time on contacting. Don't get lost. Don't get institutionalized and sucked into the pay-to-play. I mean, if you want to use it a little bit, that's fine. But there's mm-hmm. too many talents out there that are stuck in the pay-to-plays 24/7.
Yeah. I mean, and you're also putting all your eggs in one basket. Why bother being self-employed if you're going to you're literally kind of relying on one place, one stream of income, you know, and from one place. The idea of making and forging relationships with a bunch of different clients is that when one drops off, you still have a plethora, hopefully, of clients that will sustain you. If God forbid, something happened to one of the pay-to-plays and they, you know, something happened and it went down, where is your income? If you were relying on that website solely for your income and getting work, it's kind of, you're shooting yourself in the foot. So that's why I've just been it's a lot more work, like on the front end, I'm not going to lie, but you know, it's like doing that research. It's easy to sign up for a pay to play, but it's also expensive. And you're doing auditions all day long.
No, nothing but auditions. You know, there is such a thing these days that a client will hire you based on a clip on your demo.
Mm-hmm. And most of my clients that hire me on a regular basis now that I've forged relationships with over the years have, you know, hire me. That I literally wake up and they, you know, I wake up in the morning and most of the time I open my inbox because I wake up late compared to most people. But basically, by the time I wake up, I have a few emails in my inbox, and they're like, most of them consist of, hey, Trish, how much? Here's the script. How much and when can you have it done for us? I don't really audition very often at all. So, you know, I kind of want to help talents, you know, get that kind of, you know, not relying on auditions, because the amount of auditions that you do doesn't matter.
No,
you know,
and that's a big part of our program too. We spend a lot of time, you spend ample time with our students on marketing. And this is mm-hmm. something that I also see in the forums that can be pretty alarming. You'll see somebody, hey, I just spent 6 months working with a coach. I got a great demo. Now what do I do? I'm like, why, mm-hmm. why are you asking a group full of amateurs what your next step is going to be?
Right.
Even if you're and somebody pushed back a little bit on this in my pros group. Well, not all coaches cover marketing. I'm like, that's great. But even if they're doing script performance, they should refer you to somebody who does and not leave you hanging.
Right.
You know, that was my whole point of that whole thing. It's just, it's a little bewildering that people can go through an entire program and then not know what to do once they mm-hmm. have their demo. And that's, I just don't think there's an excuse for that.
Yeah, I mean, especially with how much some of these packages, some of these coaching companies are charging for the training and the demo, but not offering the how to get the work. It's like right. You pay all this money to do these demos and get the training, which is a good chunk of what you need to do. But you kind of need to know how to market yourself and how to get the work. I mean, if you don't know what to do with the demo once you've gotten it and you've already spent, you know, you're already several grand in the hole, you know, it's a good investment, but at the same time, if you have to pay even more to get the marketing, you know, it's like, well, why did I sign up for this big, you know? So I'm glad that we offer that.
Yeah, that's the whole thing that's always confusing. It's like, you know, you've gone through an entire coaching program, but yet you're in the middle of the jungle somewhere with no compass.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like,
yeah, exactly.
They shouldn't have put you in that position. I don't care if they're a marketing or a script coach or whatever kind of coach. This should mm-hmm. always be a mentorship, and that compass should always be provided.
Yeah, I'm really glad that we offer that. And I love teaching it because I get to see how students, like almost daily, I really get to see, like, you know, with those marketing sessions and with our students that they're so excited at the end of it. They're like, oh my God, I had no idea that it's simple, but it's not easy. So it does take some time to learn how to do this stuff. But with a 1 hour session from me, a marketing session, I've literally had people get work less than 24 hours later because I give you the blueprint to actually like get work. You have to do the work yourself. We can't do that for you. But if you're willing to put the time in, it's easy to do. It's just, you know, it's simple. It's just not, you know, you just have to sit down and actually do it. But
well,
I give you the steps.
I know you do a good job because when I do a session with somebody at the very end of the session, when can I work with Trish again?
Aw.
No.
Maybe we should offer more marketing sessions.
Yeah, well, we kind of are. And this is kind of leads me to this because you're going to start doing more. Now, there's going to be a difference between a straight up marketing session versus like a business session. Tell us a little bit about what's going to be covered in those.
Yeah, you and I have been talking about, you know, how can we offer even more value to our students and within our packages. So we've been talking about this business, you know, obviously because of especially, I mean, most of our students are all over the world. I mean,
right.
You know, but most of them are in the U.S. But even between the states, there are a lot of differing laws and regulations when it comes to starting a business. So I can't talk too much about the tax aspect, but I can tell you, you know, that basically like Terry, you have an S corp and I have a sole proprietorship or a DBA. You know, you're in Minneapolis. Or you're in Minnesota, I'm in New Jersey, my CPA tells me that until I make a certain amount, which I'm not making yet, I don't need to upgrade to anything else. But a lot of people do an LLC. So there are a lot of differing things, but I can also give you the basics. So we're kind of talking about offering an extra session about, you know, just what to do, you know, getting your business certified with your, you know, local, you know, your business name so that people can, you know, you can open up a bank account and start having people write checks to that name, you know, and some basic tax ideas and invoicing. A lot of people don't know what to do when it comes to invoicing. There's a ton of software out there, but, you know, so yeah, we're talking about offering this extra session about the actual business aspect. Of course, I always encourage people, if you want to take a course, like a local business course at your local community college, or, you know, take some sort of small business, you know, course, that is not going to hurt, you know?
No.
I mean, it definitely, if it's local, they'll be able to cover a lot of the local laws and stuff.
Well, it's the same way even with voiceover, you know, taking an improv class or some type of a stage mm-hmm. acting class. There are no cons mm-hmm. to that.
Right. Yeah. Even though I'm terrified and have never done improv.
Well, yeah, it is. That's the exciting part of it, is it is terrifying. It's like, you never know what the hell's going to happen. But oh my God, what a great exercise to help you think on your feet, especially if you're doing any kind of character work.
Yes, and. But that's all I know.
that's as far as
I can get.
Yeah, and that's good advice about taking a business course at a community college. You know, anything, you know, any type of small business or entrepreneurial class or whatever, even like some type of a meetup group. I know that they're not really called meetup groups as much as they used to be when we started Voiceovers on Demand.
Well, no, they are meetup groups because they're on meetup.com.
Is meetup.com still around? Because everything I organize now is through Facebook. So I honestly didn't know the website even existed. But back then, it seems like you were working more out of that website, where now you can do a bunch of gatherings via, the Facebook event app and all that stuff.
Yeah, they may have lost some business from it, but I think there's still definitely some groups that are meetup, and a lot of them have gone to Zoom.
Yes.
During COVID, obviously, because you can't meet up, actually physically meet up anymore, or right now. So a lot of those groups went to Zoom, and it can actually be more effective to network that way, because everybody's there and everybody's looking at each other on the screen, and then everybody's putting in their information in the chat, and you can connect with whomever you would like. And, you know, it's actually easier than walking into a room full of 30 people and trying to find the best people to connect with, you know.
By the way, this is interesting because, you know, I do theme park promos, rules and regulations of the park and different announcements around a variety of theme parks. And I don't know if anybody knew this before, but isn't it kind of funny when you're not even at the park, you're not doing the announcement live, but somebody tells you a month later that they heard your voice give out a rule over the PA system and everybody booed you?
Way you're changing the subject, Terry.
I'm totally all over the place. Mr. ADD over here. But isn't that funny? I got booed and I wasn't even there.
I think it was
a rule. It was probably some type of a mask mandate or some type of COVID regulation. That's just a prediction.
Yeah.
I'm speculating probably. But
you should go over there and wait for somebody and wait for it to play and then just record the
That would be
a great little video. Yeah, oh my, do a TikTok video
about
it. Oh my
God, that would be a great TikTok video. Look at everybody booing my announcement. It could have been smoking or something, too. I mean, I've heard the weirdest stories of, somebody was swearing at the PA system. I'm like, dude, you know that I'm not really standing there with a mic, right? That I recorded that announcement 5 months ago. But the reason I completely changed subjects is an email popped up from that said client who wants me to do more of them. And I couldn't.
You're checking your email while you're doing this?
Of course.
You truly are ADD.
That's what ADD talents do.
Oh, God.
And by the way, if you are an ADD talent, it just means you're extraordinary.
Oh, actually, you know what? So if you have another minute, I would love to talk about an ADHD kind of solution that I found recently.
Yeah. Are you qualified to be giving out medical advice, Trish?
No, it's not medical advice. So, I've never been officially diagnosed, but the people that I know that have been diagnosed, I have all the traits. I have just never been officially diagnosed, but I'm 100% certain that I am ADHD. But anyway, so apparently there's something called body doubling that is recently kind of become a term. When it refers to ADHD, if you find yourself, because I find, like, if I have a visitor, right, they come over, I love to cook people dinner. That's what I do. Like, for my friends, I'm just like, hey, come over for dinner, we'll catch up. And I love to cook. Like, I'm an acts of service person when it comes to I don't know if you know the five love languages, but anyway, so I love to cook dinner for people and chit-chat while I'm doing it. Well,
awesome.
We sit down, we eat, and then I get up and I clean the kitchen from top to bottom while I still have a guest. Now, if I cook dinner for myself, I do not do that. I push it off and I procrastinate, usually until the next day, and then do the dishes or clean the kitchen countertops and all that. So apparently, though, that is a thing of ADHD. You find that doing mundane tasks while you're focused on someone else, or have some sort of focus while you're chit-chatting with someone, or some kind of like direct like connection with someone, or presence, is a common trait of ADHD. You know, do you fold laundry when you have people over? It's like you choosing to do a mundane task, finding it much easier to get done when someone is present, someone else is present. When you're by yourself, you procrastinate the hell out of it. So body doubling is something that is new, and it's a new term. And I actually joined a Facebook body doubling group for ADHD people. And what it is it's a Zoom version. So you go on the, you basically connect, and it can be more than two people, but it can just be two people. You keep your microphones off. You state the task in the chat that you plan on doing, and you do the task while you're on Zoom with the person.
Who knew that they could listen to a podcast episode and get all the voiceover advice in the world that they would need, and a cure for ADHD from Trish Bassani?
It's just, to me, it's actually helped a lot with me, because I wind up sitting and just, you know, how easy is it to go down a rabbit hole on the internet when you're supposed to be doing something else that you really need to do?
Guilty of that. And honestly, this is really good advice, because if you're a voice actor, whether you're new or experienced, you probably have some form of ADD.
I know people, and I know a ton of people in our industry that struggle with getting their invoicing done. Something as simple as asking for money, which we need to live, and for some reason, we just don't want to do it, you know?
It doesn't even matter what it is, you know, and then that is really, really strong advice for many of us
who
have those
issues. Join
the
group. If you find, like, it's really helped me, I'll get on, like, I'll be like, okay, I'm here for 1 hour and I'm going to get my invoicing done. And I go into this group, this Facebook group for body doubling. And it basically, like, there's people in the background folding their laundry. There's some people who just have their mics off and they're on their computer. Nobody's talking to anyone else. It's just having the presence of someone else to say, okay, I need to focus on this task. As much as I don't want to do it, it's easier to get done and not as easy to procrastinate when you have someone holding you kind of accountable for it. So, you know, if you want to join the group, message me, I'll send you a link to it. You know, I actually posted in the pros group and did have a few people join the group because of that. So I hope that it helps some people.
You know, any creative business that's going to be, not just creative business, but especially a creative business, that's going to be sound advice. And absolutely. Speaking of groups, if you are listening to this podcast via Apple Podcasts or iHeartRadio, Spotify, we do have a Facebook group for new voice actors. Just look for Voiceover Camp. You can get to it by going to facebook.com/groups/voiceovercamp. And you can find Trish and I. In fact, the group is moderated by mostly voiceover coaches like Trish and I. And it's honestly a pretty decent way to get started. You can do a search for it, too. And if you're interested, if you've done ample research, and we always tell people to spend time researching the business, researching coaching companies. If you've done all that and you always like what we have to offer, you know, send me an email. It's contact@voiceovertraining.info, and we will chat.
That's
great advice. Trish, I'm going to let you go in about 2 minutes because you've got your own coaching session coming up here. Did I say coaching session? It's Friday, ladies and gentlemen, and apparently happy hour has begun. But you've got your own starting up here in about 20 minutes, so this will be a relatively short sermon. But before you go, are you working on anything new and exciting that maybe you haven't worked on before as far as like voiceover? Because I've, you know, I have my usual e-learning theme park announcement stuff, but, you know, I've gotten into the COVID PSA stuff again, and that was kind of you know, that was kind of parked for a little bit. But now those are really coming back because, of course, the mandates keep changing and there's a lot of work to be had there. But anything new that maybe you haven't seen in a while?
Yeah, well, I kind of hooked up with, of all places, honestly, like India is a really tough place to get to work, get work from, or work with sometimes just because of the currency exchange rate. It's just a lot of times that they just don't have the money to hire Americans for talent. But right. I do have a fairly new client in India that I've been working with that hires me for, oh, crap, and now that I mentioned it, I can't remember the actual name of them, but they're basically like pitches for, like, between I'm trying to think of what they're called. It's like they're, she has a name for them, but anyway, it's, they're just like a little pitch to the, I think it might be the ad agency, but it's basically like a pitch between companies from the marketing company on, you know, it's like an information on how they kind of launched this campaign and the results of the campaign. You know, it's like, hey, this company, this corporation, this brand worked with this other brand, this marketing company, and the marketing company was able to raise their social media awareness for the brand by 47% or whatever. You know, it's like all, and so they're kind of these little just blurbs of, you know, they're a couple of pages. They're only like 2 to 3 minutes long. So that's kind of been something new that I'd never really done before, I guess.
Cool.
And I'm assuming that's what you were asking, but, you know, it's always interesting to, you know, just hear the different things that go on between, behind the scenes. You know, this is not broadcast work. This is, you know, kind of just, this is one company letting another company know their success.
Right. And then you can learn so much. You can just learn so much from working with a client, not just what's in the script and the voiceover, but you learn from their experiences. I mean, I swear to God, if you needed open heart surgery, I could probably perform it based on all the medical narration I've done and working with doctors and scientists and surgeons and, you know, all the stuff that comes from the medical companies, you know, throughout the years. It's amazing how much we know now compared to 20 years ago just because of our job.
It's true. I know a lot about a little about a lot of different things.
Right.
And, you know, it's cool at parties when you come out with like just this random fact about something weird. And they're like, how did you know that? I'm like, I'm a voice actor.
Oh, yeah. You just spit it out. Like it's like you went to college for this or something. Or, well, I happen to be a heart surgeon. You know, it's just amazing. So, well, I will let you go because I know that you have to go and work with somebody here. But I do want to mention that in our Voiceover Camp Facebook group, too, Trish does the occasional Facebook live video. Now, that is kind of like a Q&A, correct?
Yeah, most of the time I just kind of leave it open to let people just in the chat ask questions and I just answer them. I can pretty much handle. I've been in the business a lot. Terry, I feel like a dinosaur sometimes, but honestly,
like
when it comes
dinosaur,
to being in.
I'm going to be 54 in October.
I'm not even talking about how old we are. I'm just talking about how long we've been in the industry and like the fact that like there are some people in this industry that have been in it even for a decade that don't know about some of the things that we had to do early on to get work. You know, it's kind of crazy. Like the CD days, you know, like it's just kind of, you know, it's like there was a time where my demo only existed on a CD. I didn't have it on a computer. I actually ripped it from a CD to get an MP3 version of it.
Oh God, remember that when you had to actually rip it from your CD?
Yeah, because your producer wasn't connected to the internet, so the producer who produced the demo would create the demo and then burn it onto a CD and send you home with that, and that was the file.
That's,
you know,
amazing.
Like that was the file you used.
And a little tougher to do if you have a cassette of your first demo, like I do. I have a side A is commercial and side B is industrial. The industrial narration side.
I just missed the cusp of like when things were just changing over to CDs from cassettes. I remember seeing cassettes and being aware of them, but I decided to thankfully use CDs because they were more up and coming and definitely being used
CDs,
more.
It didn't seem like they were. I mean, CDs were great, but you know, for me, it was always more fun when you were close to something tragic happening, like an album. You could scratch the album or it could start skipping, so then that was kind of alarming. The cassette would be eaten by your car stereo, so you were close to tragedy there. CDs were a little too picture perfect.
And they were expensive.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they were expensive to reproduce and send out because you had to pay for the postage, you know. It's like, but it's cool though, because I still have some clients that I've been working with for that long, 15 plus years, that, you know, and I just had my 17th anniversary. Yay.
Oh, congratulations. I saw that post.
Yeah, so, you know, but yeah, 15 years ago, like I've had clients for as much as 15 years, and they know, and I still work with them because I once sent them a CD.
Oh, that is amazing.
That's kind of weird.
I remember the old days when you used to really try to butter up a talent agent. You'd send them like a dozen roses with your CD in the middle of them.
Yes.
Or really the like clever packaging, you know, when clever packaging to a talent agent was a thing.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's true.
Well,
I know.
If I just
send
make it look like this, they can't ignore me.
I don't even send Christmas cards. I'm terrible. I'm just like, some people do it, and I'm just like, I don't know. I'm just kind of, I send postcards to, like, you know, new people, but like newer clients or newer connections. But I just generally don't do the Christmas card thing. I just never wind up sitting down and getting
honestly,
it done.
Honestly, it's better that you don't do them than doing one of those, like, online Christmas cards where somebody just punches in everybody on their email list and everybody gets the same card. You've been great. You've been a great client, and like 500 people got the same email.
Right. Yeah, I've seen those.
Not real.
Plus,
not real.
There's very little effort.
So,
yeah.
Well, Trish, this has been great. Thank you for coming on. And those of you that are interested, the shortcut to hear all of our sermons is voiceoversermons.com. But of course, you can subscribe anywhere you listen to podcasts, which would include Apple Podcasts, iHeartRadio, Spotify. I think we're on Google Play. I don't even know what the Google one is called, but we're on it. I think it's called Google Play, but and then of course you can find us a Voiceover Camp on Facebook. Trish, good luck with your coaching session later, and thank you for being a part of our team, and thank you for coming on this podcast.
Yes, thank you. Enjoy your weekend, Terry. We'll talk soon.
All right, you too. Take care, everybody.
Okay.
Talk soon.
Bye.
Thank you for tuning in to the Voiceover Sermon with Terry Daniel. See you next time for more useful tips and tricks to help make your voiceover business run better.